Okay, very good. So finally it starts. So let us review the and rediscuss this formula and the implication and the reintroduce the concept of resummation, how it was introduced for the first time in here in order to improve the behavior of post-Newtonian series as they are. So summarizing yesterday what I said, if there is post-Newtonian theory in for a system of general binary system in circular orbit, you compute the gravitational wave luminosity, which is the E over dt, and this has the Newtonian piece, that is the 32 over 5g nu square over x to the square times a post-Newtonian correction that is given, this post-Newtonian correction, by the sum of the higher order multiples. So basically you have the HLM square there. Since we are in circular orbits, as I was saying, the H22 is something proportional to, let's say, is actually x e minus 2 e phi, where x is omega to the 2/3 is the frequency parameter that, I mean, Kepler law means that this is v, and you are doing an expansion in this parameter that is, in fact, I mean, the velocity of light here is, as this appears, is this quantity, so you are doing an expansion where this quantity is small. So, as I said, this is the outcome of standard post-Newtonian calculations that, when you look at the review of Luc Blanchet, you will find that the final result is given by this. So this is the gravitational wave luminosity, then there is the energy of binary system along circular orbit, or the Hamiltonian, I mean the energy along circular orbit, or the Hamiltonian function that I mentioned before. But for the moment, let's focus here because I want to rediscuss what I discussed briefly yesterday. So, and in particular what I was saying is that the beginning of the new trend, let's say, this idea of improving the behavior of post-Newtonian result in order to have them to make them predicted also when the velocities are not small and the gravitational field is strong, is this paper, so Damur, Iyer, Satya Prakash in 1998. And I will redo the plot that I was doing yesterday. And we consider, again, a particle along circular orbit on Schwarzschild, background. And in this case, you can solve Einstein's equation in the following sense. I mean, you do perturbation now around a curved space-time. So the metric is g mu nu 0 plus a perturbation. Evidently, this is Schwarzschild. And now you can do perturbation theory solving the equation for this thing. What happens is that since you are in spherical symmetry, you can expand this h mu nu in spherical harmonics, that will be tensor spherical harmonics. And once that you have this, you can actually plug all the you have various functions, I mean, you have the 10 components of the metric. Actually, as before, I mean, it's a multipolar expansion, so you split this thing in odd, let's say, magnetic spherical harmonics, tensor spherical harmonics, is the same thing that we were saying before, and even or electric spherical harmonics. At the end of the day, you find you can plug all these the multiples together in the sense that here there are 3 functions, here there are 7 functions, and eventually you find what is the Regge-Wheeler-Zerilli equations. I will rediscuss this later on. But anyway, what you solving the problem of gravitational wave emission from a particle on Schwarzschild, on circular orbit, is a very easy, simple case, amounts in solving a wave equation with a potential equal to a certain, to a source, that, and the potential is, okay, it is a potential, and the psi, will be psi lm actually, will be given, is a single wave function that the various multiples are combined in a single function that is related then to the gravitational wave emission. This is just sketchy, then I will re-enter in some detail. But anyway, the point is that it is easy, or let's say you know how to do this, and you can solve this equation numerically and get the exact results. So if we go back to, so this I said, the Moore-Ayers at Prakash 1998, we go back to 1995, there were some papers of Poisson and others. I mean, Poisson did the post-Newtonian expansion for, this equation can be solved numerically and you have the exact solution, and can be solved as a post-Newtonian expansion, so getting these terms, when in the case where nu is equal to zero, so you have a test particle. And then the game was to compare the exact solution to successive post-Newtonian approximation. And there is this plot, if you show the luminosity divided by the Newtonian thing, Newtonian flux versus x. Okay, then I will say something. You have a function that starts from 1, then it goes down, then keep growing. This is the exact solution up to the last stable orbit. Okay, so this was the exact result. And then you compare the successive post-Newtonian approximations. That is the flux, let's say the F hat, Pn, is something that is schematically 1 plus x 3 halves. Actually, here there will be, yes, actually, here there is, let's say, a minus, then another minus, then in the plus, and so on and so forth. You truncate the series, and at each truncation, you get a certain approximant. And you find that one is here, the other one is here, the other one is there. Next one, he said, maybe it is converging because it looks closer. Then you go to the next order, again, something that is messed up. So this was the said, the conclusion was, okay, you cannot use post-Newtonian theory close to the last stable orbit or where the velocity are small. Post-Newtonian theory can be good, just this. I cannot do anything. This was the, say, the old way of thinking. I can use post-Newtonian just here, and let's say from here on I have to resort to better numerical method, solving the Einstein equation in dynamical way. Actually, when you read this paper, that in fact it is here that I wanted to, how did I do that before? Because I was here, maybe, yes, exactly. So this is the paper, and yes, but this is just to give you a flavor of what happened at the time. Yes, so this is the, maybe it's too much what I was doing. But this is exactly the kind of plot that I was saying. So there is the exact, which is the solid curve, and all the others, each one does what it wants. So V is this, okay, is X. So once that you read this paper, it is, as I was saying, the origin of the bad behavior of the post, one of the origin of the bad behavior of the post-Newtonian expansion is that you have the energy in the post-Newtonian expansion, and the energy of a test particle are on circular orbit on a Schwarzschild background is this, and it has a pole at the light ring, the last unstable orbit. And if you expand this way, you have a pole, and the test particle, the Taylor series sees this singularity, so you have a bad convergent thing. So the idea was, okay, first I factor out this piece, so that I know that there is something exact there. So why should I use it in post-Newtonian expanded form? I use it exactly. So I factor it out from this original series. Then I look at what remains. And I want to improve the behavior of what remains. And the idea of the time was to say, okay, I have a Taylor series. The simplest thing that I can do is applying a Padé approximant. What is a Padé approximant? Because in fact, I realized that when I saw that, maybe nobody knows what is a Padé approximant. Padé approximant means replacing the Taylor series with a rational function. A rational function such that so basically we're replacing this with a function 1 plus n1x plus tatak-tak nnx divided by, sorry, yes, n1 and np, let's say, 1 plus n2x plus pa-pa-pa nqx pxq, such that p plus q equal n, the original, the highest power that occurs here. And these coefficients are determined in a way that when you expand it, you go back to the original things. Okay? So this is what you can do. There is a theory of Padé approximant that tells you, I mean, in a way, you are here. What you see is, when you do this thing, is a simple way of resumming a Taylor series. In the sense, well, resummation means replacing a Taylor expansion with something that is non-polynomial, in this case a rational function, and usually this is better. Also because in this way, I mean, you will have an infinite number of, I mean, when you re-expand, you get some all the series. And what was happening at the time is the following thing, that the exact curve is here, again, and then you find a certain stability, in the sense that when you change the order of post-Newtonian approximants, all the curves are here. So I would not say that this is improvement of convergence, but rather you have a stability of the thing. And then from this, you said, okay, now I can use the post-Newtonian information that costed, a lot of blood in being computed, and I can use it also in the strong field and high-velocity regime, okay? So this was the beginning, because this was the first paper where that showed that you can use post-Newtonian information in a useful way. And in this paper, they produced for the first time in spiral templates that with also the new dependence that were reliable up to the last stable orbit. Okay, so in a sense, this is something important that one has to keep in mind. And in general, the other takeaway message is that this is a technique that is not tuned to the gravitational wave stuff, in the sense that you can use everywhere. I mean, whenever in your life of a scientist you have to do with series that are badly behaved, that are because they come from asymptotic expansion, you can try to improve their behavior. And the idea here is very, there are two steps. So first, if I know that there is something exact, if I know the physics that is there, and I know the physics in non-expanded form, let's try to use it. So the idea is I factor it out. And when I factor out something exact, what remains, and especially if it has a bad behavior, what remains will probably be have a milder singularities or will be more stable. And then the next step, for example, you apply a Padé approximant. So that this is, I think, is used everywhere in quantum field theory, wherever you have this kind of solution. So this is a message that you can retain in general, independently for this. Okay, now, this piece is something that can, I mean, it was the beginning and was a way to take take better into account the emission. Now we stop here about this for a moment, and we change a little bit topic, because this will be useful later. And we keep going, actually, on we study what a particular binary system. Particular binary system is a, again, the test particle plunging on Schwarzschild black hole. Why this? Because there is a lot of information that was, let's say, accumulated along the years, and that was, in a sense, in the background when the effective one-body approach was created. So, first, okay, let me how is it that I am so unable to use my own computer? Ah, yes. Okay, archivio apri recente. Yes, is this one. Okay. Vista riproduci presentazione. Okay. Yes, actually, I want to start from this. 1972. Actually, so 1972 is an important year. Before this, there is actually 1957, and I would say 1970. These are crucial years. Why? Because, yeah, this is the kind of equation that I was mentioning before, in the sense that in 1957, the Rege-Wheeler equation was born for perturbation, so non-spherical perturbation of Schwarzschild spacetime. Then I can show you how this, the exact representation of the potential and the source, but let's say the source is combination of the multiples of the of the source of the stress energy tensor, and the potential is 1 minus 2 over r times something that is simple. I don't remember it by heart, but okay. So Rege-Wheeler in 1970 wrote this equation for the odd perturbation. In 1970, Zerilli, that was another student of Wheeler at the time, did this for the more involved case of the even, so the electric perturbation, because in fact here you have to start from only three Einstein equations that you have to combine together. Here you had 7, so the work was much more involved. And then what did they study? So let's say it's 1970. 1970 is the year where Weber, for the first time, claims that he has detected gravitational waves. So Joseph Weber is the pioneer of the idea that gravitational waves can be detected in a laboratory. So working basically alone in the 60s, he thought, okay, this is a real effect. He built a gravitational wave detector, which was a bar detector. This bar detector was working at room temperature, so its sensitivity was very low, but still he developed all the ideas and he wrote a book about this, so he was really the pioneer of this. So the idea is what? This is a bar detector, which means a heavy mass, the gravitational waves arrives, the detector blah, 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 vibrates like this, and you detect the vibration. So there are all these famous pictures of Weber that is working on this big bar. And in 1970, he claimed that he had detected gravitational waves in a period, in an epoch, where nobody had really any idea of what kind of sources existed, what kind of emission looked like, or whatever. I mean, you don't really... you had just... actually, the only calculations was the circular case or the Peters-Matthew calculation of two objects along on elliptic orbit. I mean, the formula that gives you the leading order for the binary pulse. So, on the one hand, what happened? Weber did this claim, And then immediately other groups start building bars in Italy with the group of Amaldi, in France. And after a few years, they said, okay, maybe Weber, what did you see? Have you seen anything? So there was a bit of a controversial thing. Weber was maybe not so happy of this, and he kept seeing something, but still he was really the pioneer, the one that had the vision that you can detect gravitational waves in some form. But contemporarily, theorists also start computing. Okay, so, and in particular, is it fine? Yes. And in particular, there was the group in Princeton that was, okay, the big boss was Wheeler, but then there were the students, and it was Ruffini there that has his own group of people. And one wanted to go beyond the simple flat space-time stuff. So the obvious thing to do was to say, okay, we have a Schwarzschild black hole. I think the name black hole existed already. Not even sure, because in fact this paper is the Schwarzschild singularity, the stability of Schwarzschild singularity. So there were all these analytical calculations that were done by hand, and I assure you it's far from trivial to get all this. And there is this paper of the really that is tremendous, in the sense that it is a PRD where there is the first part that are just the results that are summarized in a very compact way, so the wave equation and the source. And then there are five or six appendixes with all the technical details, with also some typos, I think. Anyway, there was all this analytical information there, and so what kind of system can we compute? Well, we want to understand what is the gravitational wave emission from the simplest thing we can imagine on a Schwarzschild black hole. And what is the case? The case is a test particle that is plunging radially on a Schwarzschild black hole. Actually, we have to mention that in 1970, there is also another important thing, that is a paper of Vishveshvara, let's call it Vishu. What did this guy? This guy did one of the first numerical simulations in history, in the sense that he took a Schwarzschild black hole, he took the Reggio-Wheeler equation, and he just took a Gaussian wave packet of waves, he sent it on the black hole, and he looked at what was coming back. And what was coming back was something that, okay, if you have the time that is here, and that is doing something like this, then there is a peak, and then there is what is now known as the ring down tail. So I'm not sure that he got all the deep detail of this, because in fact you have to wait from Chandrasekhar for to understanding precisely what is going here. But the response of a black hole was very characteristic, in the sense you send a pulse of gravitational wave, and what you get back is a certain oscillation with always the same frequency, I mean, after a while. So this was a sort of characteristic signal, characteristic emission from a black hole, so that, if I can see this thing, I will be sure this is a black hole. So next step was to say, okay, not a Gaussian wave packet of waves, but a particle. A particle that is representing light, a delta source. So they computed this thing. they solved numerically the equation, and what they got was that kind of wave. Okay, the time here goes from right to the left for some mysterious region. And in fact, in 1971, there is an important paper that is Davis, Ruffini, Press and Price, yes, DRPP, where they actually computed not the waveform, but the energy spectrum of gravitational waves. And they find that the energy spectrum, the peak of the spectrum, is close to the characteristic frequency of this wave. And then I remember once Ruffini was, I mean, Ruffini is actually telling this story every time, but the idea is that at the time there were two groups in the US that were working on the same problem, let's say. So once that, I think, Press and Price realized that the other were doing the same thing, let's say, okay, let's do things together and let's publish together, but just the spectrum. And then Ruffini was telling, yes, but we have the most interesting thing, that was the waveform. And the waveform was in fact published the year after in this paper, Davis, Ruffini and Tiomno. So what you see here is the first ever calculation of the gravitational wave emission from a binary black hole coalescence, although in a very simplified scenario. So a black hole, a test particle that is plunging on a black hole in this way. And here, so what do you have here? So you have this precursor that you can actually represent quite well with a quadrupole formula when the particle is accelerating in the potential of the black hole. Then, when the particle crosses the light ring, which means the photon orbit, there is something that happens, and it is the excitation of the modes of the black hole. And these modes of the black holes are very fastly dumped because gravitational wave is emitted, and then you see this ring down tail. So I wanted to mention this because it is important. And then this calculation remained the same and the only, in fact, for years, or better. The same calculation was generalized to the case of two black holes of equal mass. It was what is called the head-on collision of two black holes. And they were the first numerical simulation that was doing this. And they were find sort of the same signal. And you have to wait until 2005 to have the exact simulation of the two black holes plunging one against the other. But also, what I want to say is that you have to wait until, maybe I can show you another paper, you can wait until 2006 to have the generalization of I am unable to do this. Where was it? It was here. Yes. You have to wait until 2006 to see the complete binary black hole merger in the extreme mass ratio limit. It looks strange, but it was not done before, even if all the techniques were there. Ah, yes, but I have to tell you about the dynamics there. So you see here it is the trajectory of this particle that is moving and it is plunging. But there is a problem here, because you need this radiation reaction in order to make the particle plunge. And in fact, what I forgot to mention here is the following, that it is convenient to use Hamiltonian dynamics, and for Schwarzschild the Hamiltonian is this, where, okay, you have the radial momentum, but what is really important is the potential, 1 plus the effective potential that it is useful to write in factorized form, 2 over r, 1 plus p phi square over r square. Okay. And let me remind you what this potential is telling you, so that when you plot this object, you will see that is in general like this. So this is 1. This is the stable orbit. This is the unstable orbit. So if you start, evidently, if the motion is just geodesic, if a geodesic motion, you are here, you will remain here forever. But in reality, you are emitting gravitational waves, and the Hamiltonian dynamics, I mean, should not be conservative. You need a force there. And the trick was to say, okay, the angular momentum is not conserved. I need a dissipative term here. What should I use? In principle, if you wanted to do everything self-consistently, you should solve numerically the Reggio-Virzarilli equation, compute the waves at scribe plus, then put them in compute the flux, then put them again inside the thing, and with a bootstrap procedure do this. Okay, we did an approximation to this. So we use post-Newtonian results, the ones that I was mentioning before, in a resummed form, and we put the flux here. This, I mean, actually, you can do this also just using the Newtonian leading order thing in order to see the spiral thing. One wanted to do things more accurately in order to compute the waveform in a good way. Now there are better techniques and this calculation can be done more accurately. But this is the point. I mean, you need this thing, so you need the plunge, you need the radiation reaction in order to do the plunge. And it was very surprising because we did this in 2006 and nobody had done this before. So whatever you were looking at in the literature, it was always radial plunge, radial from infinity, radial from finite size, scattering. But the beauty of this was to put together two different approximations. I mean, on the one end, the perturbation around the Schwarzschild spacetime, and on the other end, the flux that is computing from post-Newtonian theory and then resummed. And so we computed the waveform. And when you look at the wave, yes, sorry, you're right. Here there are all the formulas that I stressed yesterday. So all the HLM, the luminosity, the angular momentum with the combination of the multiples. But and maybe I also wrote explicitly the expression for the Reggio-Virzarilli potential. Doesn't matter. Okay, these are the source piece. Technicalities and. Yes, so this is the waveform that you get for a particle plunging radially from finite size, but when you have the inspiral, you have this kind of waveform. Okay, that looks like the waveform that you get in a numerical relativity simulation, but the frequencies are lower. Okay, I was talking about this thing. I don't remember why I stopped, because what I wanted to say here is that, yes, there is the f of phi, so the angular momentum flux that is here, and this is doing what? It is changing this part, no? The angular momentum is changing progressively in a self-consistent way, no? Because you have a function, you have the evolution, and since you have this flux on the right, this takes away angular momentum. Taking away angular momentum means what? Means that this thing moves here, and this peak goes down progressively until you get a moment where you arrive to a moment where you have an inflection point here. And this is what is called the last stable orbit, LSO, or the ISCO, innermost stable circular orbit. And for Schwarzschild, this happens at R 1 over 6. What does it mean? That if you are here, you are on a circular orbit. A circular orbit that progressively moves, no? Because the potential is moving dynamically, and in the meanwhile, you keep this thing. And then, at a moment, this is flat. You cannot remain here anymore, and you plunge. The important thing is that, also something that was actually understood during the UB, thing is that this transition is not an abrupt transition, it's something smooth continuously. So you plunge, but in fact you plunge while you keep in spiraling. And I mean, this was actually shown in the UB But this is just to introduce you to simple concept and to before introducing the effective one-body approach. Actually, this calculation came later the EUB was introduced, and also after the numerical relativity simulation, and has been used as a test bed for several ideas that we have been developing along the years. But what was absolutely important was to stress the relevance of the whole calculation, of this whole calculation of 1972. Because the main structures that you see now in a binary black hole coalescence of two black holes, equal mass, spinning, whatever, is qualitatively already here. That a priori was not expected. I mean, what I want to say, what I want to say is that we discussed yesterday the fact that you have higher multiples also. What do higher multiples do on a waveform? They make the waveform look like this. So, for example, this is a waveform, because you see, the 2-2 mode you are always using. Okay, I have the 2-2 mode. The 2-2 mode does like this. Grows, merger, and go down. But if you have higher multiples that have a different structure, different amplitude, and different frequencies, and you put everything together, your waveform will look less nice and less simple. But in fact, if you are able to detect a waveform like this, you are able to go back to the geometry and of the system. I mean, you are able to say if you detect higher multiples, you are able to say whether better, let's say, you have better constraint on the mass ratio, the spins, and this kind of thing. Okay, so this was the main thing. Is there something else? No, nothing. Okay, archivio, maybe it's this one. Yes, okay. Okay, let's go back to, yes. Okay, now that we have seen what you are expecting, what you know is there in the test particle limit, let's go back to the comparable mass case and to the idea of doing of using better post-Newtonian results in order to have them predictable and stable also when the velocities are high and the strong field is interaction is strong, gravitational field is strong. So let's say we have to go back historically, no? It's 1998. So in 1998, there is the DIS paper, and with this resummation, with just a Pader resummation, because in fact, the idea was shown to work in the test particle case. Then it was extended also to the comparable mass case. And in this paper, they proposed, let's say, new filters, new templates that were better than the standard post-Newtonian one. There are, I think, three or four papers of Damur, Iyer, Satya Prakash, all around, let's say, 1998 and 2000, where they analyzed all the possibilities, and they clearly show that you don't have to use standard Taylor expanded formulas to do this. This was, let's say, it is funny to realize that after 2005 and 2007, when after the numerical relativity people were able to do things, they went back to look at these papers because they had not believed to this at the time, and they wanted to recheck and be convinced that what was said at the time was correct. Anyway, in 1998, so what do we have in 1998? In 1998, in 1999, we have the 1972 paper, and we have also the first numerical simulation. As I was saying, there is these head-on collisions. It was the so-called called the close limit approximation, in the sense that when you have two black holes that are very close, you can it was the time when you could do numerical simulation of this thing. You could actually replace this with an approximation that was a distorted black hole with a point particle and evolve this. And also in that case, you could see a relatively simple signal, just the ring down signal. And then there was also something else that was called at the time, I think it is 2000, the Lazarus approach. Why Lazarus approach? Because what happened at the time is that you had the numerical simulation that were on huge code, huge machines. And the problem with this numerical simulation, they were not able to do more than half an orbit, basically. So the code was crashing almost immediately. And there was a group, I think they were at EAI, it was basically Manuela Campanella and Carlos Lusto, who said, okay, the code crashes, but what do we have here? We have something that is a perturbation of a Kerr black hole. So let's use a perturbation theory, let's say the version of the Reggio-Wheeler-Zerilli stuff that when you do this on a Kerr black hole, in fact, you can write a similarly wave equation that is the Tucholsky equation, and let's use the outcome of the numerical simulation that has crashed as initial data for this Tucholsky waveform, let's evolve it and see what we get. And again, they were get a relatively simple signal, no, with this in spiral like the ones that it was showing, then emerging and ring down. Of course, nobody was believing to all this at the time. No, it is too simple. This is full GR. It should be something incredibly complicated. Because a lot of people were very influenced by the vision that was coming from the US, essentially popularized by Kip Thorne and this group, and clearly explicitated in the book of Kip Thorne, that is Black Holes and Time Warps. We said, okay, we know that we have an in spiral. Here it is just post-Newtonian theory. Post-Newtonian theory cannot go much after, let's say, the last stable orbit, 1 over 6. Then here there is something, well, maybe not this way because it is a function, but anyway, very unpredicted, that is the merger. And then there is the final phase that, as I said, yes, okay, is the ring down phase. Of what I forgot to say is that at the end, when you have a single black hole, the single black hole is distorted. And there, again, you can use perturbation theory. And you can compute these oscillation modes so that you know very precisely the frequency of these oscillation modes and the relation between these oscillation modes and the property of the final black hole, in the sense that if you are able to detect, in effect, this is what happened. I mean, you can measure the frequency of the final signal and you can go back to the angular momentum and the mass of the black hole. So let's say, in a sense, the idea was hic sunt leones. Okay, I doubt they understand, but okay, at least. And there is the final ring down part that was, so this was the idea, let's say the status at 1998, okay? Okay, this vision proved eventually totally wrong. And, but despite this, in fact, yeah, it's a very particular period because you see, in 1998, there is LIGO, is clear that will be starting in some way, no? They are already building the detectors. I remember that I entered this business in 1999, and my first, because I got my thesis, my Laura thesis in 1999, and the first conference I attended was a gravitational wave conference. And they were saying, yes, we are building Virgo, we are building LIGO, we are there, the instrument will appear at some stage, but there were no waveforms. No waveforms at the time. Numerical relativity was not working. We know, they knew that the important signal could have been emitted by binary black holes, but nobody had any idea of what kind of signal, of really computing the signal in order to see it to extract it from the data. So this is the first step. And then in 1999-2000, there is the first answer to this problem, and it is the EOB approach, so effective one-body approach. That there are two fundamental papers, okay, Buonanno de Moore, in these years, with the first paper in 1999. I mean, it is interesting to when you look at the story, because up to 1998, okay, Thibault is doing this with Iyer and Satya Prakash, and then and in the meanwhile there are other papers that they are doing quantum string cosmology and all. Alessandro goes there originally for working on string cosmology, and they did some papers on string cosmology, and then tack, they change the topics and they start doing this because it became very urgent. So okay, so this is the historical side, and what is important is that there is this new approach that now I will try to discuss in some detail. I have another hour, right? Is it true? Okay, oh, great. And in fact, what they did, these two papers, they produced the first prediction of the full waveform from binary black hole coalescence. Prediction that, okay, it was based on ideas that were coming from all the knowledge of Hamiltonian dynamics. It was in some sort inspired by some pieces, let's say the transition from the plunge to merger was inspired or related to the paper of Davis, Ruffini and Thiomno of 1972. We don't have to forget that in 1974 is the year where Thibault arrives in Princeton to work in the group of Ruffini. So that all these ideas, it was all these things were there, were in the air. It was really part of the of his culture. Okay, in fact, it is funny because this paper, until a few years ago, had very little citation. The DRT, the Davis Ruffini Thiomno, while the other one, DRPP, was cited everywhere. Then we see this is more American, this is less American. You get your conclusions. Anyway, yes. So there are this idea. Then there was this closed limit approximation that I was mentioning, and there was this Lazarus thing that also I was mentioning. So all these things, all these ideas that were in the air, in a sense, condensed together here in these two works. And at the end, they got a waveform that looked like this, and then a ring down tail, okay, with the following. So it is interesting also to know this. In the first paper, there is this idea, it is introduced to map the two-body problem into a problem. So you have two bodies, you map it through a canonical transformation and an energy transformation into the motion of a body whose mass is the reduced mass of the bond, okay, of the system, moving into an effective potential, let's say, an effective metric, which is just, if you wish, a calculational artifact, because eventually you have a mapping between two Hamiltonians. There is a canonical transformation that transforms from one coordinate system to the other, but this is what you have. So I was saying this. Why was okay? I missed the thing. Yes, this is the idea. Yeah, because I was saying this. Right. So in the first paper they had this, and they wanted just it was a sort of improvement of this paper, although with more refined structure. In the sense that here they said, okay, there was a radiation reaction, they were computing the spiral, and they were stopping at the last stable orbit. Because the nice thing of the method is that it is attached, it is rooted to what you have in the test particle limit, in the sense that the most important thing is the fact that the non-perturbative information that you have in this potential is the fact that you have a last stable orbit, and then you go to zero. In other words, that when you look at the potential, the 1 minus 2u, you have, let's say, an horizon. Let's put it in this way. Which means that you need this kind of non-perturbative structure that you won't have in any post-Newtonian expanded thing. Because when you do post-Newtonian expansion, whatever, you cannot go there. So you just get this thing, and all this information is lost. So the most important thing was to transpose, to flex, to modify, to this structure into the case of two objects with the same with the comparable mass ratio, and this allowed eventually to compute the waveform up to merger. But then what happened? Then, and this was computed using the quadrupole formula, the formula that I wrote at the beginning, just r omega e minus 2 a phi. This is what was done at the time, but with the dynamics behind that, on the one hand, the radiation reaction that was coming from the Padere summation of post-Newtonian results, and an Hamiltonian that was a particular Hamiltonian that I will discuss later, but that incorporates this kind of structure and that allows you to have this kind of behavior. But then at the moment, I mean, it's just a quadrupole formula, as I said, no? In quadrupole formula, if you had everything and you would include the ring down and all that, you would have an infinite amount of terms here that were not included. So, okay, the first step was to say, okay, I stop at the last stable orbit because the formalism predicts a last stable orbit, and I can do a better representation of the Inspire. This is the first paper. In the second paper, they said, okay, transition from inspiral to plunge. Since that there is, I mean, when you solve the Hamilton equation, you didn't have anything that was impeding you to go beyond the last stable orbit, so to get closer. So, okay, they just keep going. And you said, okay, here I am the last stable orbit, let's go beyond. But then at a moment, in the real thing, I should have the light ring, and I should have the excitation of the quasi-normal mode. This is not included in this waveform, so I have to put it by hand. And this is what was done at the time, and it is still done now, although this part is very much refined now. Is driven by the orbital frequency. Sorry, the light ring means the peak of the photon potential. So the photon potential is U square A for Schwarzschild. You can check this on any book. Good. And then there was, okay, let's do a transition, a fast transition. I know that I should have excitation of quasi-normal mode, so my dynamics here predicts a certain value of the angular momentum, a certain value of the energy. The energy will be the mass of the final black hole. The angular momentum will be the angular momentum of the final black hole. This will give a certain prediction of the quasi-normal mode stack. I can compute this thing. I attach the two waveforms together. This was the prediction, 2000, purely analytical. I mean, use Mathematica to solve the ODE's equation. At the time where there was nothing. And they did a certain amount of qualitative and quantitative prediction that then were checked carefully after 2005 when numerical relativity simulation were working, and with the what was the number? Yes, so a lot of this prediction were within the 10%. Still, for the case of non-spin, still using a very rough approximation. So this was the 2000, and the first thing was using starting from the dynamics at 2pn. Then there was in 2000, yes, sorry, 2000. In 2000 there is also the 3pn, but Alessandra is not there anymore because I think it was the time where she went back in the US. In 2001, Thibault wrote the first generalization of this thing with spin. And in fact, when you look at this paper, I think the paper is very technical and is pure Damur style, so you have to be very, very, very motivated to read it from the beginning to the end. But what I find is absolutely amusing is the acknowledgements, because Thibault is very friend of David Blair. I think they were together in Princeton. And in the acknowledgements, right, I am grateful. I thank David Blair for the question who prompted this work. So probably David Blair asked him, "Oh, Thibault, this is very nice. What about spin?" And he said, "Ah, yes, that's true, spin." And then he wrote a 35 pages paper. So it's great, I think. But so 2001, and then in 2002, you have the first comparison between the analytical model and numerical relativity simulations. Although these were very simple numerical relativity simulations, where you had two black holes along circular orbits. So this is what we're able to do in France. In 2006, you have spin precessing already. Or actually, it was 2005. And then it was after this year that I entered in the game, starting rechecking with new numerical simulation and also in the test particle limit each building block of the model and improving it along several directions. And nowadays, this is very mature, although there are a lot of things that you would like still to improve, but this is the way you have computed the templates that were used for gravitational wave data analysis. Okay? And so this does not exist. This exists. Now that I did the simple thing, because this I was just speaking, okay? Let's try to do the difficult thing. So we'll try to go back to the original paper and to sketch at least the derivation of the mapping between the real thing and the effective thing. And probably I will do some mistakes. I mean, I will stop at some stage and problems, but okay. Okay. Did I say everything? Yes. Because in principle I could just show you some slide and tell you, okay, just read the literature. But I want to be very masochistic and see whether I'm able to say things that are meaningful or just a lot of wrong things. So first of all, the paper in 2000, it was working at 2 PM, okay? And it was building on the 2 PM solution of the problem of motion in GR that was derived by Thibault and Gerard, so Thibault Damur and Gerard Schaefer, in a paper of 1988, High-order relativistic periastron advances and binary pulsar, that was published on Nuovo Cimento. This is a fundamental paper, and it is incredible that this fundamental paper was published on a review that now is, I mean, does it exist still? Yes. Okay. There were other times, okay? Maybe. And what happens in this thing? So first, there is an amusing thing that I want to tell. So this is the moment where Thibault and Gerard, that have been collaborators for years, I mean from the time they were together in Meudon. It was, I think, 1 year before Thibault got appointed as a permanent professor at EHS. And and let's put it in this way. What I was saying, Thibault worked mainly deriving the equation of motion for the problem of two-body problem in GR, binary pulsar, and all that, but working with the Lagrangian formalism. On the other hand, Gerard was convinced that, I mean, that you can do things in an Hamiltonian way. And in fact, here is the paper where the 2PN Hamiltonian, I think, appears from the first time. And this is, I forgot to write it here, but in the, I mean, it is what you saw yesterday. And there is an, okay, so this is an interesting thing. I mean, when you put two people, high-level people together, there is always something interesting that comes out. High-level people, and then there is the funny thing. If you look at the literature before that, you find this spelling, for example, Thibaud, with a D. This is the French way of writing this. Then, this is what I was told. I mean, isn't it interesting just to relax a little bit? Geralt told him, "Ah, yes, but you know, Thibaud is actually Theobald. This is a German name, which means brave in front of God. So, you know, Theobald, something like that. And from there, on papers, you find an L and T." It's a nice detail, but it is, and I mean, it is again saying that, okay, names are conventions. There is always some gauge transformation that you can use there that is funny. Okay, but let's go to the thing. Now, because now it's getting hard. Now it's getting hard, yes. Okay, so what we can get from this paper? So from this paper, yes, so this is the starting point of the UB. And first of all, here you have the Hamiltonian written in ADM coordinates. So one of the problem with the motion of bodies in GR is that when you do the Lagrangian formalism, I don't think you have ordinary Lagrangians. You have Lagrangians that always depend on accelerations. But there are some particular coordinate systems where this does not appear. And one of these coordinate systems, this I think was pointed out about Schaefer, is the Arnowitz-Desner-Misner coordinate system that was used in the 60s to quantize gravity. So if you use this coordinate system, you can have an ordinary Lagrangian. I hope that God does not kill me for what I'm about to say. And if you do that, you can use you can do a ordinary Lagrange transformation, and you can write the Hamiltonian at 2PN. I would like to have it on the screen somewhere because archivio apri recente. Oh, it'll be stable. Yes, so I add it here. Sorry for being so messy in doing this, but it would have taken some time that I didn't have. So let's say the 2PN results, actually the 2PN motion in general relativity was actually known from 1982, I think. And also this is funny because I was checking the literature here, and in fact it is, yes, where is it? Sorry, because I have to say this also, because I think this is interesting. Because anyway, the some results are published in a book that was yes. It is 1983. And it is published in Physical Review Letters and also in Proceeding of Journée Relativiste 1983, edited by Benenti, Ferraris and Francavilla. Wanted to stress this. Okay, so you have the Hamiltonian dynamics, that is this. P is the, what I was saying, no? So you have the relative momentum, there is the symmetric mass ratio appearing everywhere, you have the radial momentum, and the Q is the radial thing. Now, what they do in this paper is to solve the two-body problem using the Hamiltonian formalism, or better, using the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism. And in fact, this is the this is the thing. Let's suppose that I remember Hamilton Jacobi, and let's suppose also that you remember how Hamilton Jacobi works. But you have to say an action, and you just can go through Landau-Lifshitz, and you will find that in this paper there is a straightforward application of the solution of the problem of motion in Newtonian, or the problem of motion of where you have a potential that just depends on the radial coordinate or theta, on the Landau-Lifshitz book, and the action, energy is conserved, angular momentum is conserved, so you can solve the dynamics with separation of variables. So this is the angular momentum, and all the calculation amounts in doing an integral of some function that depends on the energy and on the angular momentum. Okay, let me check where I had my notes. Yes, this is the last thing. Yes, exactly. And they do this calculation explicitly, and I think it is very instructive to look at this paper first, because it's a nice paper, and it is there are interesting historical remarks on top of the physics. But then what is really useful is that this is an action variable, and that this will be used for the UB thing, and I will tell you how. So you have to define this quantity that is given by Armin, the inversion points of these objects. And where this function, once that you have done some calculation, has a structure of this form. Over r square plus d1 over r cube plus plus, actually, sorry. So let's write it explicitly. D2 over r4 plus d3 over r5. Okay? So solving the problem by quadrature means, in fact, doing this integral and solving this integral. So the nice thing that you have in this paper is that Hamiltonian mechanics is the basis of the basis of the old quantum theory, a la Sommerfeld style. So that in fact it is said explicitly that these integrals were the kind of integrals that were well known at the time of Sommerfeld, when you were using the old way of doing quantum mechanics. So that in the and this is the central technical difficulties of this paper, so that they give in the appendix the an explicit formula for doing this, and in fact these are the kind of integrals I think that you have the two poles, and you can compute them in the complex plane moving the contour. I am not ashamed to say that I don't remember all these things in detail, although I have studied this in some stage in my life, but I know that all this information is here, and this can be instructive and useful in general to know that this exists. Anyway, at the end of the day, they give an expression of this, and they compute explicitly this action variable, and from this action variable, they compute what is called the Delaunay Hamiltonian. So they use action angle variables, but eventually they compute something that is called the Delaunay Hamiltonian. What is the Delaunay Hamiltonian? The Delaunay Hamiltonian is an object that was used to Newtonian mechanics in the 19th century. Because what do we have here, actually? Here we are looking at some perturbation on the Newtonian potential. This is what we are doing here. And in the 19th century, anybody was doing motion of planets. This is what they were doing all the time. So what you are using here are using some old information. And the Delaunay Hamiltonian that I will write in 1 second, that comes out from here, is nothing more that the diagonalization of your Hamilton operator to what you are used in quantum mechanics. In the sense, is a function that when you promote your variables to be discrete, are the energy levels of your system. And in fact, when you present this typically in one slide, the idea behind is that, okay, you have a classical system, but you have to think quantum mechanically. Because the idea is that you compute the Delaunay Hamiltonian for the two-body system, and which means compute the energy level of the two-body system, and then you have an effective system. And in this effective system, this particle moving into effective potential, you can solve the problem again using Hamilton-Jacobi equation. You can again compute a Delaunay Hamiltonian. You can again compute energy levels. And then you do a one-to-one mapping. So let me see whether... no, it's not this, this slide. It's the other one. yes, it's this one. So you have to forget about this, but you have this. Let me see whether... Yes, exactly. So, I could have given you... I will give you the final result, but I think it is instructive because one should do this calculation at least once in his life. I did it in the past. I was hoping to have the time to redo it in detail. I did not do that, but I will go through it step by step, just to show that more or less I know what I'm talking about, more or less. Here you have this. So this is the Delaunay Hamiltonian. No, as I said, you start with the 2pn thing, and you do this integral that I was mentioning. This is written explicitly in the end. And in fact, once that you have done this integral, you have some variable, action variable, that is function of the energy and the angular momentum. And you can invert this, and always you work order by order. That is, here you have an expansion in C, so that whenever you have to invert and solve this equation, you always expand. So you have an expression of this thing, and you can invert this object, and you define the energy. This is what is there, the energy, non-relativistic, because I subtracted mc square. And there is n, this n, that there is shown like if it were quantized. Maybe I can do riproduci presentazione, yes, this way. But in fact, there is, you define this variable, so okay, let's try to see whether I'm able to go through the steps. So you define this action variable, yes, so I said. You define this action variable that comes from the integral that I was saying, that is done with the Sommerfeld technique, okay? Okay, then from this you scale this variable by, I think, don't remember the thing, but this is not very relevant. I mean, you have a scaled version of this. I don't remember what is alpha, but I think it's just the coupling constant or that. Yes, what was the charge at the end? And then you define a new variable that is this IR plus the angular momentum. I'm not sure it is written here, but yes, this is not important. Okay, and then you have some coefficients, and eventually you can write the energy. So these are really the energy levels of your system, in the sense that if you think that, if you kill all these pieces, this is the Coulomb problem. So that if you say N is the NH bar, this is this, This is the charge of the electron and all that. This is the quantum Coulomb problem. But evidently, you go beyond. Ah, yes, what I have to say is the following, that this, in fact, all this depends only L, the L that appears here, is the magnitude of the angular momentum. So the system is spherically symmetric. It does not depend on the three components of the angular momentum, but just on the radial component. Which means that if you want to represent this in another form, into some potential, this potential will have to be spherically symmetric. This effective metric will have to be spherically symmetric. Yes. And okay, and these coefficients are okay, just look like this. Okay? So this is part of the game. You have the energy level of the 2pn post-Newtonian thing. And you already see when you have this description is much simpler than the original Hamiltonian in the M coordinates. You have already done something. So you have, let's put it in this way, you have diagonalized the Hamiltonian. And these are the observables. I hope that I'm saying not too many stupid things. Okay. But then you want to have to transform this description in something simpler, let's say. And right, the inspiration. I forgot to mention this, because the idea of mapping the two-body problem in general relativity into an effective one-body problem was attempted at least other two times, at least another time before in the story. But in fact, what is said in the original paper is that the inspiring ideas that led to this work came actually from a paper of Brezin, Itkinson, and Zinjustin of 1970. Ah, yes, indeed. I had not noticed that again, the 1970 is a very important year. Where they were studying, what they were studying, positronium state. I mean, a quantum system where you have two objects, two charged objects with the same mass. And they were mapping this object into this system, into an effective system, and they were, I mean, it was a quantum system, so they were thinking in these terms. Energy level, and I split them into, map them into another set of energy levels. So this, I think, is the idea. And in fact, Thibault confirmed this to me once that I asked him. He told me, I was in the countryside. I was looking at the papers that were there. I was reading this paper, and I thought, maybe this is an idea that could be useful for this. And in fact, it proved useful because it worked. So, although everything can be improved, it is clear. So, as I said, the system, let's go back to the effective system. So, in Newtonian mechanics, you know that eventually you will have this effective potential where you move. Here we are in GR, we start from a metric, and so you want to map your two-body problem into something, so a particle, M1, M2 divided M1 plus M2, something that is moving into an effective metric. The effective metric is spherically symmetric, so you write it like that. You write it also in Schwarzschild-like coordinates, in the sense that you have the R squared there. This is not needed a priori. I mean, it's a choice that you do. And then you have a problem that, I mean, you have the formal problem of a particle moving into this potential. And again, in order to do the mapping, you use Hamilton-Jacobi method, and you solve the problem in this form, with the difference that now these coefficients are just formal things. There is the other point that you, this is the thing, right? Now I understand what he was saying. There are these two functions, A and B. I have to postulate a form for these functions. We postulate that these functions are given as a post-Newtonian expansion. What I probably forgot to say is that the potential, doing an expansion in the potential is like doing an expansion in this, okay? So here you have 1 PN, 2 PN, am I saying it correctly? Yes. No, probably is the contrary. This is Newtonian, this is 1 PN, this is 2 PN for AR, this is 1 PN and this is 2 PN. Okay, but this is a formal thing, and then you follow all the steps, you do the calculation, you compute the Delaunay Hamiltonian also in this case, so you compute the energy levels, and eventually you get this form. So the idea is what? The idea is that on the one end you have the exact system with these own energy levels, so this is what I was sketching here. So this is the real system, okay, with its own, it is a schematic thing, and on the other end you have the effective system. Okay, so far so good. I have the principal quantum numbers that labels the states, I have the angular momentum, and I can do a one-to-one correspondence, but now there is the subtlety. We are in GR, so the rest mass density for one object is mc square, so m1 plus m2, c square. And then, on the other end, I have mu c square, m1, m2 divided m1 plus m2, c square. That is, if it is true that I have a one-to-one correspondence between the energy, the number of energy levels, I need something that relates the fact that when you are not moving, in one case you are here, in the other case you are there. So you cannot just say, okay, this is equal to the other. You need something else. And the something else is, where did I write it? Okay. Yes. Because you are in spherical symmetry. You are in spherical symmetry because the two-body problem, the two-body problem, once that you write the Delaunay Hamiltonian, depends only on the radius and on the modulus of the angular momentum. So you don't have dependence on the other components. So everything is spherically symmetric. So that's the reason why you postulate this. Okay. I mean, diagonal, okay, it is partial. If you wish, you can write it in another system of coordinates where it is not diagonal. I mean, here there is no frame dragging. Here there is no frame dragging because we are talking about the, we are starting from an Hamiltonian of two objects that have no spin. Okay, actually, the same kind of thing can be, although slightly different, can be done where you have spin. And in that case, when you go to the test particle limit, because the idea here is that when you go to the test particle limit, you go back to the Schwarzschild case. Mm? If you do the same thing with spin, and there are several ways of doing that, when you go back to the test particle case, you go back to a particle moving on curve. And in that case, you have the frame dragging. Although, yes, so a good way of, pedagogical way of showing how the EOB was built and how it worked is to use this effective metric and you think in this form. But eventually, you forget about this. I mean, you connect Hamiltonians. Now I don't remember. Ah, yes, I was thinking. Okay. The last thing is the following. So yes, you need to postulate the thing. You need to postulate a map that connects, okay, the, let's say, the energy of the test particle, so H0 divided by M0 C square, M0 is like mu, it doesn't matter, with the real energy divided by mu C square, and this is also, so in general, you have this, is a function, is a function of the real energy, of the real energy level. Okay, you cannot just say this is equal this, because if this is equal this, the rest mass thing does not work. So you need to impose that there is a function, and again it's another function that you write as a post-Newtonian expansion, and probably I wrote it explicitly, did I? Yes, I did, thanks God. That is this. So eventually you have a system of equations, so you have the correspondence between the energy levels, you have the correspondence between the actual value of the energy, and then you impose that when you go back to the test particle limit, the first coefficient, okay, said A1 equal minus 2, A1 is this, okay? And once that you put together all these conditions, you find that the equation actually have a solution, which means that you have not done things too badly. I mean, evidently they tried several things. Yes?
To?
Say it again. To, I mean, yes, of course. I mean, I'm not using old quantum mechanics. I'm using the techniques of old quantum mechanics. The two massive objects, but okay, it's a good point. The point is that there are two black holes, that's true. But the two black holes in post-Newtonian calculations are represented like delta functions. The Hamiltonian that you have there represent black holes, represent neutron stars up to 2pn, and you forget about horizons and all that. So you have the dynamics of two objects that is given by an Hamiltonian. And it is a classical Hamiltonian. And I can work on this classical Hamiltonian as I like. So if the old quantum mechanics, I mean, I said old quantum mechanics just because typically people are more used to quantum mechanics than to classical mechanics. So, and also this Delaunay Hamiltonian, I mean, is a classical concept. It's just that it was used in quantum mechanics, but to give you an idea that this is like if we had the energy levels. The point is that these energy levels are not discrete, but are continuous. Okay? Quantum mechanics, I said quantum mechanics just as a tool to help intuition. Point is what now? Yes. You can solve all this system of equations, and finally you find a solution, you find everything. And you find everything in the following form. First, there is a simple map between this effective Hamiltonian, so the Hamiltonian of the effective particle moving in the effective potential, that is connected to the real Hamiltonian by this relation. And when you invert this thing, you find that, in fact, you have a new Hamiltonian for the system. I mean, you said, okay, there are the energy levels, but this is an Hamiltonian, so it is the Hamiltonian that is related to the effective Hamiltonian by this relation. And here is the, Luca, this is the answer to your question of 2 months ago, your old question. Yes, your poor guy, the poor guy. Where are the resummation coming from? Yes, where are the resummation coming from? The first resummation is here. because here there is a square root appearing, and which means that you will have something in non-polynomial form. And then what is the effective Hamiltonian that you get? Because what we did, the expansion with the to say that. So the idea is this. So you have the J effective, okay? I never thought about this actually, but it came to my mind right now. So you have the J effective. This J effective, as it is here, depends on certain parameters. A1, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Okay? And then you have A and B. But if you have an effective Hamiltonian, you know that the effective Hamiltonian can essentially just be written like J effective P mu, okay, not this way, but okay. Let's put this in this way. You can say that this is the M0 square, the mass of the particle, G effective nu, P mu, P nu. And from this, the P0 square components is the Hamiltonian, the effective Hamiltonian, okay? So, once that you solve the system, you get all these coefficients, and you can write an effective Hamiltonian. And what happens? It happens that the effective Hamiltonian at 2pn level, let me rewrite. Okay, here there are a few things that are not fully explicit, but it can... yes, I didn't write it anymore. Yes. Okay, the effective Hamiltonian, okay, at 2pn level, because when you start going to higher pn is more complicated, the effective Hamiltonian looks like this. So once that you do this, now this p mu, p nu, blah, 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 a few notation, because typically in all these things we use reduced things, so that H hat is actually H, the real Hamiltonian, divided by the reduced mass of the system. Then you have our function, 1 plus P phi square over R square plus P R star square. So let's forget about this for the moment, the radial momentum. This is what you get at 2pn. What is the A potential? So, as I said, the A potential is given by this series. You solve the equation and you find values for these coefficients. And this is what you get. Let me redo this on the blackboard so that I have it at hand and I can play with this better. 1 minus 2u. And this is field plus 2 nu u cube plus, this is 3pn contribution, but for the moment, forget about that, A4 nu u4. So, what was done in 2000 was, I mean, 1999 actually, was this. Now, there are some amusing things that occur. First, if you, first it is this. This is the full 2pn dynamics. The thing that before was on 20 terms is now this. So the 2pn dynamics is given by what? You have the EOB thing given by, okay, let me rewrite it. Each time I don't remember it by heart, it's a shame. So you have the total mass, square root, 1 plus 2 nu minus 1, okay? This is the total mass. This is what I was mentioning is the symmetric mass ratio, m1, m2 divided by m1, m square, okay? Or mu divided by m. So you have this. You have this. In a particular system of coordinates, because this u is in fact 1 over r, okay, let's say m equal 1, wherever it is, and this coordinate is actually a particular coordinate, is an EUB coordinate, is the radial separation, but is in fact coordinate that that is a new dependent deformation of Schwarzschild coordinates. And when you go to the test particle limit, what happens? Well, test particle limit, this disappears, this disappears, and you get just get h equal square root of h. I mean, you expand this square root, one square root goes away, and you only have this piece. That is precisely what you have when you say, I want the Hamiltonian of a test particle on Schwarzschild. This is the thing. Okay? Now, yes, the important thing, there are two more important things. If you do the calculation just at 1 pn, everything disappears. In fact, those among you with a eagle eye, I mean, whatever, you will have noticed that this is a post-Newtonian series, but here there is something missing. There is the u squared terms missing. The u squared term missing would be the 1 pn correction. The 1 pn, poof, goes away. I think that there are deep reasons for this, but I am too simple-minded to understand it. I mean, because when you look at 1 pn also, in the 1 pn calculation, the equation can become come out very simple, simple to the linearized case, simple, same structure what you have on Schwarzschild, just wave equation times something. But anyway, okay, please don't. So the 1 pn term disappears, which means, I mean, it disappears here. Evidently, it is hidden within the square root. But this also indicates that when you say, I want to study the two-body problem in general relativity, I browse the literature. Ah, yes, there is the 1 pn Hamiltonian. Oh, there are 10 terms. This is very complicated. I have to go there. Why? Everything is here. You don't need that thing anymore. But where is the thing? The thing is hidden here. Because if you expand this, and if you go back from the EOB coordinates to the ADM coordinates in which the original Hamiltonian was expressed, you will get it back completely. So things are packaged, are simplified, so you are in a good coordinate system here, where a lot of stuff disappears. But then there is more. So this is the 2pn, the 2pn thing, and it is the trivial thing. And you notice that the sign is plus, not minus. Which means that if this is an attractive term, is the usual Newtonian term, this is a repulsive term. Repulsive term means what? Means that you can go to smaller, closer distances. And from this a potential, evidently, you can. Okay, let me look at this. So you can compute the potential that is there, because yes, okay, this is the other subtle thing that I want to stress. So let's plot this function 1 minus 2u. So for Schwarzschild it is, this is 1, this is a of u, tac 1/2, 0.5. If you have this, you find another function that goes here. But in fact, it has a zero. If it has a zero, let's say it is small, it means that the function, the effective potential that it is this object here, will be a deformation of the Schwarzschild effective potential. And this is not by chance that it is there. In a sense that you have imposed something very strong, that when you go in the test particle limit, you get this. And then all the rest is a perturbation of this, but a perturbation that is not small. But you want to have a leg very well rooted on the non-perturbative properties of the Schwarzschild method, of the dynamics of test particle on Schwarzschild. So this means that, again, you will have a potential, and this potential will look like this. But what is the difference? The difference is that when you switch on the symmetric mass ratio that, as I was saying, ranges between 0 and 0.25. The last stable orbit, and in general circular orbit for the given angular momentum, it will move inside. So instead of getting this, the last stable orbit at 6m, you will get it at some radius smaller than 6m. Okay. And that's basically it at 2pn level. So from this Hamiltonian, you can compute the dynamics. This dynamics, so you can write Hamilton equations. And you will need a rule to eliminate the angular momentum. So for example, I mean, the simplest thing is to say, okay, I have my UB Hamiltonian that is like this, three lines. I have the angular momentum flux. Yes, what I was saying yesterday is that the angular momentum flux is h dot times h. Now I will forget the numbers, the all the powers of omega, but it doesn't matter. So let's say we saw yesterday that the energy flux for circular orbits is just 32 over 5 nu square x to the fifth, where actually x is omega to the 2/3, so this is omega to the 10/3. The angular momentum, the flux of angular momentum, that is what is called f phi, is, you can see it doing the calculation from h dot, is 1 over omega times this thing. So in fact, this is modulo probably a coefficient that I don't, should be this one, but I think there is another, no, maybe no, it's correct, good, yes. 32 over 5 nu square omega to the 7/3. So, without knowing anything, without knowing nothing about higher post-Newtonian theory, you can say, okay, I have my UB Hamiltonian, that is there. I put a flux in the equation of P phi. You code 10 lines in Mathematica, and you have solved the two-body problem in NR, seeing yourself the transition from the in-spiral to plunge. And then if you also want to see how the gravitational wave look like, no problem. This is why I gave you the formula yesterday. There is a pi over 5, I think, or minus. Okay, let's put it r omega square e minus 2i phi. Qualitatively, everything is here, is in there. And you have nonlinearities from GR at 2pn level. Removing all what you have after. But, you can see it yourself, so you can convince yourself that you can compute the potential, you can see, for example, how the potential varies while this object, the force, takes away angular momentum, and, it is a simple pedagogical exercise. All the rest that exists are improvement, subtle also, of this main idea. Okay? What else I wanted to say? Okay, tuck, 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 tuck. Tuck. Yes. The next complication, because what I wanted to say is that, I'm an idiot. The idea is this, but let's have a look at the archivio a prerecente, maybe it's this one, yes. So what I wanted to show you is the outcome of the what you have in the original UB paper that I'm sure I put it somewhere, but is to see whether if there is a slide that is doing this or not. But it should be somewhere. Yes, exactly this one. Ah, yes, right, so that I remember that I have to say a few things more. Riproduci presentazione. Yes, because we have to go back in 2000 to think what people were thinking at the time. So, this is really the waveform, the prediction that it is in the 2000 paper. And the prediction is really working at 2pn, so it is using this only. It is using an expression for the angular momentum flux that is Paderi summed, more or less what I told you before. And for extracting the waves, it is using essentially this formula here. Maybe instead of r omega, it is probably using omega to the 2/3. That is what you have when you impose Kepler law. So the 1 equal omega 2 r3, the 1 to 3 law, along circular orbits, because I said we are circular. So, In several of these calculations, that is implicit. And the assumption that you are along circular orbit. Circular orbit means that you always have this Kepler constraint, and several equations are simplified by this. But this is correct when you are along the spiral. As soon as you plunge, and your dynamics become faster and faster, the Kepler law does not hold anymore as is. So this constraint is violated. And so you should relax these constraints here or there. But let's say at the time it was just this. And this is you see precisely what I was saying, so that you have the spiral. And then, precisely. So when you solve, you can see it yourself. So when you solve Hamilton's equation in this case, you can compute a quantity, I was saying, that is the orbital frequency, which is phi dot, the orbital. No, sorry, I was saying that. Hurry up. So is the phi dot, the phi dot stuff. And when you compute the evolution of this, you find that this has a peak. The fact that this has a peak is related to the fact that this thing has a zero, let's say it is a small. And let me remember whether I can show it in one go. Yes, because one of the Hamilton equations, I don't have it here. Anyway, believe me that. So if you don't have a zero here, or if this function, for example, does something wild, you won't have a peak. And the fact that the orbital frequency has a peak is a feature that you have in the test particle limit. In the test particle limit, this corresponds to the peak of the Regewiller. Okay, I didn't enter in this detail. To the peak of the Regewiller really potential, and it is where the quasi-normal modes are excited. Actually, quasi-normal modes are the poles of the Green function. In order to have them excited, you need a certain amount of frequency that is here, so that the omega is in fact the source that prompts the fact that the omega grows fast. It is what prompts the excitation of the quasi-normal modes in real life, but okay, in quotes. That waveform was computed in this way. You solve the dynamics. At some stage you have this waveform, ta 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 ta. You arrive, you get to a certain point here, and that corresponds to this peak. And then here you change the description and you attach this to a superposition of quasi-normal modes. The reason being behind this being that when you are in the test particle limit, when your gravitational wave frequency is at the peak, you are at the light ring, and this is the moment when the quasi-normal modes are excited. Okay, it is because the light ring is the last unstable orbit. You have waves that are there, and it is an unstable point, let's put it in this way. you have something that it is on an unstable in a location, and so they cannot stay there forever, but they have to decay. And waving. Okay, this is the thing. What is then important to show here, to stress? What is important to stress is the transition from in spiral to plunge is very smooth. It is blurred. This is what they found for the first time. It is a smooth, a continuous transition because the potential is continuously moving. Okay, you are plunging, but while you plunge, the potential is moving with you. So it's keeping you up. And the level of adiabaticity of the transition depends on the mass ratio, depends on the spins, I mean, depends on the structure of the dynamics. But let's say it is, I mean, at the time, somebody was thinking that, okay, you have things that circular orbits. I mean, it looks strange to think about this now. I mean, to believe that people were really be convinced of this. So you are on a circular orbit, then you have a sequence of circular orbits, then you arrive to the last stable orbit, and then something, you plunge together. No. But somebody was thinking about this at the time. So among the results that they found was precisely this smooth transition between the in-spiral and plunge. So you plunge while you keep in-spiraling. And so there were a certain amount of prediction. This is what I was saying. And also what you have to remember is the following. Since the transition from in-spiral to plunge is so smooth, is blurred, the last stable orbit has no real important meaning. I mean, it is something that is there that allows you to guide intuition to understand where you are, but the dynamics is in fact a mixture of two things. It's a balance between this thing that is plunging and the radiation reaction that is moving this. So evidently you know that the plunge will occur around the LSO, but it is in a region, and in fact in the paper it was predicted how big is this region and how many orbits you are still able to do once that you have crossed the last stable orbit. And in fact this is interesting to mention. So let's say there was this paper, Brady Creighton Thor, 1998, where there was this, so the intermediate binary black hole problem. Let's say I have the in-spiral, post-Newtonian methods old, and then I have to change to something. Now I'm basically done. Okay, so this is the thing. And for years I have been seeing where I didn't know anything. I was looking at these plots around in the year 2000-2001. I mean, I have no idea what was going on at the time, because maybe I was not reading the right literature at all. While basically at the same time there is this this prediction in the first EOB paper, that in fact it is important to understand that this is rooted on the piano resummation. So now everybody talks about the effective one body approach, the resummation of Hamiltonian dynamics, blah 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 blah, and also this in all around has become a brand, I mean, something that a lot of people talk about without really knowing what they are talking about, because there are templates, effective one-body templates, that are used routinely now to do detection, but it was not like this. I mean, already 5 or 6 years ago, there was a fight to convince a lot of people that this was the way to go. But for many people that do data analysis, or other things, is just a black box, and they don't care at all of all the deepness and the deep concepts that have been developed now. Also because now there is this thing that was very useful at the time, so but can have some drawbacks. And the point is the following. After 2005, so 2005, you had a numerical relativity simulation, and numerical relativity simulation looks like this. Qualitative is like that, but quantitatively there are differences. And then What we started doing is, okay, I have the exact solution. This is an approximate solution. So I can have 3pn. In principle, I have an infinite series of pieces here. I can, but I have a prediction. So this is give me something. And I can compare my prediction to the exact solution, in quotes, modulo numerical errors. And so I can try to extract simulation from the simulation some information to complete the model. This is what is, was done, and this is what is done now and what it is used for computing templates. But in my view, this is used, but to a certain extent, this is also abused. Because it is very nice to have a lot of numerical simulation, but now there are big machines. You have the UV model, to some extent, in the practical world, has lost part of its beauty. Because since you have a lot of simulation, you can say, okay, I can fit whatever I want. And while my view is that I would like to fit the smallest number of numerical simulation and then check with all the rest. So this is the theory. Because nowadays computing numerical waveforms is to a certain extent routinary modulo something. But since you have a lot of them, since you have a method that more or less is always able to give you the right answer, in the sense that you can do things in several possible ways, you always find something that is that makes sense. You can always add parameters, you can always fit things, and you can always compute waveform in this way. But exactly, so one has to be careful. So now in the LIGO, there are, I mean, it has become a tool for many people. So there are codes that are used that compute waveforms. This is tuned to numerical relativity, or as they like to say, calibrated to numerical relativity. I prefer to say informed by numerical relativity. And this is a tool that is used to compute templates or whatever. But in fact, I think it is more used like an interpolating method. Because you cannot use 140 simulations to calibrate your method and check it with 3 simulations. You would maybe like to do it the other way around. But still, since the numerical simulation is considered the truth, you have to be compatible with the truth all over. Anyway, this is what is used. This is okay. And this is what was used for the previous things. And this is what will be used in the future. But I am afraid, to a certain way, as I said, not used, but a little bit abused because of this very strong tuning. So that I think the formalism is beautiful and is very strong and is very robust. You don't want to say, to absolutely say, it is necessary, absolutely necessary, to have a lot of numerical information to complete it. This is, let's say, current research, because it is open debate, I think, of what is really needed to complete the model, because there are several ways of doing that, and I will probably discuss it in a certain detail tomorrow. Yes, also because I didn't talk for the waveform and radiation reaction, there are other things that are useful. Okay. Sorry. 5 minutes.